Coming up next on The Voice of Alabama Politics, our guest today is gubernatorial candidate Parker Griffith. Also, the V-Team takes a look at same-sex marriage in Alabama. And Mike Hubbard's consulting contract is causing angst in Lee County. This is just the high cost of low-life politicians. All this coming up next on The V. Welcome to The Voice of Alabama Politics, where we tackle the tough issues so you have the hard facts. I'm your host, Bill Britt, and as always, I'm joined by the V-Team. Welcome all.
Good morning. Good morning, and happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day, yes, to our father on the set.
Our prolific father.
Prolific father.
Father of five in county.
Father of five, and your wife is a saint.
My wife is a saint.
She really is.
There's no way I could do anything without her.
Well, she's great. She was even up with you on election night.
She was. Yeah. She's a trooper.
Yeah, she's great. Well, good marriages are hard to come by. We call them sort of the 10th wonder of the world sometimes. Right now.
Don't look at Claire and I.
Oh, no. Nothing like that.
I believe
that.
There's something going on with the same-sex marriage in the state of Alabama.
Exactly.
There's something going on. Don't be looking at us, man.
The ACLU has filed a lawsuit to strike down our ban on same-sex marriage. What is the deal with this?
It's the fourth lawsuit to be counting and keeping up. And I don't know about Claire, but this is the way I feel. I used to be just as miserable as the rest of us. but this lawsuit, just like the other three, the first one is the one where the partner was trying to get the death benefits.
Right.
And the insurance benefits. The other three are to have the courts recognize marriages that are conducted in other states. It is not an attempt to force the state of Alabama to allow same-sex marriage to take place inside of Alabama.
Right. It's just to recognize them.
But isn't
they're married in Massachusetts, then you should recognize it in Alabama.
But if you recognize it here, in the next step, legalize it.
Yeah, it's incrementalism is what they're going
inching.
For. Sure. And you know, I've always, that's been one of my concerns as same-sex marriage has grown around the country is it was only a matter of time before someone looked at a state that didn't recognize it and said, hey, you're part of the United States. You have to recognize this based on the full faith and credit clause. And I think they're probably right. It doesn't mean that you would necessarily agree with that position, but legally, I don't know that they can box their way out of it.
And that's what this lawsuit is about. The most recent one that was filed this past week, it's about the equal protection and the full faith and credit clause. And there is a good bit of momentum. When these lawsuits typically have been filed in federal court, it is a very short period of time between when they're filed and when the court will strike down the ban. Mm-hmm. Now, the ban in Alabama was very popular in 2006 when the Sanctity of Marriage Act was passed, but this is a federal court deciding whether or not the federal laws apply in Alabama.
Yeah, so it won't go to the Alabama Supreme Court, won't have any say in this.
And that's why you don't see any of these lawsuits filed in Alabama state court for that very reason.
Right, they know there's a no win, they're not going to win here.
Well, it's an interesting case. I mean, this seems to be going that way whether people like it or not. I mean, my problem is that you call it marriage in a sense. I think some of these things should be contracts and marriage should be in the church. But I've always advocated
to take marriage completely out of the public arena, to put it back in the churches, to put it back in the communities. If you want to have a public ceremony and recognize yourself, that's fine. But there should be no benefit attached to whether you're single or married, whether it's taxation or anything else. I just don't believe that's the province of government to get involved in.
Yeah, I'm sort of you want to jump the broom with each other and hang out for the rest of your life? That's fine with me. I don't care.
Well, regardless,
on to the next subject.
Yeah, it's coming. It's coming to Alabama.
Yeah.
Well, another bad subject here then. Clyde Chambliss, who's running for the Senate district against Harris Garner, during the middle of the primary, went on Facebook and said, election fraud, be aware, election fraud. Now, we looked at that, And what Harris, Mr. Chambliss
put on. Who is he to determine that?
Well, he said it was election fraud because there were black people voting in the Republican primary. Is that a Republican position?
Let me just say this. To anybody that works in this arena that is surprised that an establishment Republican would have a problem with black people at the voting polls is just ridiculous. Because that's the sort of thing. I mean, there was a federal court judge. I get very upset about this issue. There was a federal court judge and a U.S. Supreme Court justice who said racism is alive and well in Alabama. You had a sitting senator who recorded himself voluntarily talking to Republican leadership inside our state house about how they were going to try to keep an issue off of the ballot to suppress African-American voter turnout. So this is another example. If you don't want blacks voting in your Republican primary and you don't want Democrats voting in your Republican primary, then close it.
Well, I mean, obviously Clyde Chambliss has never been to a state executive committee meeting. He doesn't know that we have a minority outreach. And there are, you know, there are blacks on the state executive committee.
The vice chairman of the Alabama Republican Party is black.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that's what I was going to say.
But there are some people in Alabama who still believe that that African-American equals Democrat and that Democrat equals African-American.
Well, that's very
shallow.
And
that's not the case.
Okay, that's just very shallow.
Well, to me,
that tells you something about him to go on Facebook and say something like that. Well, and on top of that, you get into Elmore and Autauga counties. You're going to have Afro-Americans. You're going to have blacks voting. I mean, they live in these areas.
Yeah.
They're all around Central Alabama.
And they have every right to vote in
absolutely
a Republican primary.
You shouldn't pinpoint them and say because they're a certain color, they're a Democrat.
This is the candidate of the BCA, of Bob Riley, of Dale Marsh, and Mike Hubbard. That's the establishment Republican Party for a lot of folks, and he's crying, there's blacks in our primary.
Well, they better wake up.
There's Democrats, too, because it's open. It's an open primary.
Seriously, everybody should wake up and look and see what happened in Virginia last Tuesday night with Eric Cantor, the whip, and Virginia being beat, okay?
Yeah.
Because this trend, people are a little tired of it. Now, granted, Congress has got very negative ratings. But
And Barron and I were talking about this before we started filming, and that is that if you have a predominantly Republican slate of officers, because that's where the real race was on Tuesday. It was in the Republican primary. Then you're going to have people crossing over because there's nobody on the Democratic ticket to vote for.
There were a lot of precincts. I would say probably the majority of precincts in the state of Alabama. If you went and pulled a Democrat ballot, there was one race.
Right.
Parker Griffith versus Bill Bass or Blass or whatever his name is.
Don't even know who was on the
ticket. I don't even know his name.
Bill Blass is a designer. I used to wear those
jeans. I don't think he was on the ballot. But anyway, that would have been the only Democrat race. And when they drew these districts to where there would not be any possibility of a Democrat ever winning it, to then sit back and say, wow, Democrats are migrating into the Republican primary. You know, if you want to take the racist step and say, if you're black, you must be a Democrat, and use that as evidence that there are Democrats in the Republican primary, what do you expect? I mean, people are going to want to have a say in who their representative is.
We got about 30 seconds, but isn't this what's going before the Supreme Court with this Voting Rights Act? They want to know, was this partisan gerrymandering or was it racial gerrymandering?
And when you have folks like Clyde Chambliss come out and say things like, watch out, there are black folks voting at the polls, which is not what he said. It's not a direct quote, but that was the intent behind the Facebook post. Then that's exactly what the U.S. Supreme Court should be looking at with this redistricting in Alabama.
We're going to have to hold it there. You're watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Our guest is Parker Griffith. Coming up next.
The V is sponsored by Spot On Strategies Group.
I teach. I touch the future. I am AEA.
I keep the school clean every day for your children. I am AEA.
Congratulations on your scholarship. I help children make choices for college and careers. I am AEA.
We are AEA.
Welcome to Alabama's newest entertainment destination, Wind Creek Wetumpka, the perfect escape for date night, a getaway with your friends, or a relaxing poolside cocktail. Whether it's a day trip to enjoy the best steak in Alabama or a romantic weekend, the finest southern hospitality is just a short drive away. Wind Creek Wetumpka. Find your winning moment.
In 1977, an 8-year-old boy picked up the game of golf from his father. the odds of that same boy then making it to the US and European pro golf tours? 1 in 7 million. The odds of the Big Easy winning the US Open twice? 1 in 1.2 billion. The odds of him having a child diagnosed with autism? 1 in 88. Ernie Els encourages you to learn the signs of autism.
Welcome back to the Voice of Alabama Politics. Today we continue our discussion with gubernatorial candidate Parker Griffith. Thank you for coming and spending so much time with us.
Well, it's great to be here. It really is.
When we were last talking, you called out Governor Bentley to stand toe-to-toe and debate you on the big issues facing our state. However, his campaign staff has been very, very cool to that idea. What do you say to that?
I think they're on the wrong side of the issues, and it's not anything that's hard to figure out. We know that Alabama needs a lottery for education. We're surrounded by lottery states, and they're educating their children, and their tuition bills are lower. They're coming out of college without great debt. The governor of Tennessee just announced that any child that finishes high school can go to a two-year community college without tuition charge. So we know it's essential, and we're going to do it. Bentley promised it 4 years ago, broke that promise just like he broke the promise with the school teachers. I don't think his team is going to allow him to debate. I think he knows he's on the wrong side of the issue. He's definitely on the wrong side of the issue as far as the expansion and the reformation of Medicaid. David Bronner has told him that it's irresponsible and borderline stupid not to do it. Everybody's telling him to do it. Nobody's telling him not to do it except the Koch brothers and his Tea Party team that surrounded him.
We understand that the state is losing about $4 million a week.
It's $3 million a day.
A day, right.
$3 million a day, yeah.
A day, that's a lot of money for a poor state.
Well, you know? Yeah, I mean, we're 4.8 million people. We've got 1 million people on Medicaid, 700,000 on Medicare. We have 500,000 veterans. And by the way, part of our plan to reform Medicaid would include those 27,000 veterans that are uninsured. About 13,000 of those veterans would be eligible for our Medicaid plan. And many of their dependents would be eligible. So this is a plan that should be nonpartisan. For goodness sakes, health care is essential for us to remain a competitive state on not only a national but an international stage. We've got to have a well-educated Alabama. We've got to have a healthy Alabama. And so we have to have that lottery for education, and we've got to reform and expand Medicaid.
We've had recently, or the last year, about 10 hospitals closed in the state.
Absolutely.
And there's probably more on the way. But you have a solution to that, don't you?
Yes. The reason that the Medicaid expansion was put in the Affordable Care Act was because it was to compensate hospitals for the reduction in Medicare reimbursement. So what we're watching is our small rural hospitals closing. We've got 10 to 15 additional hospitals on a watch list. This is critical. A county with no hospital is not going to do any economic development.
Right, right.
A county with no hospital is not going to recruit a physician.
Right.
And we've got our elderly. So many of our counties are populated with our older Alabama citizens. They can't go 50 miles to another hospital to have something checked. This is ridiculous. And it's also ridiculous is that keeping your hospital open is a job creator. Every hospital bed represents 4 to 5 employees. And so, you know, we're almost speechless sometimes when we realize what the leadership of Alabama is not doing for its own people.
There is a moral responsibility that government has.
Yes, it is. Indeed.
We were talking briefly about Theodore Roosevelt, one of my heroes, I would say. He took reform seriously, damn the consequences.
Absolutely.
Can you do that for us?
Yeah, I think in my age and stage, I certainly can. And I think that I am determined that we are going to change the conversation in Alabama. I am absolutely determined that the people of Alabama, not only are they good-hearted, they're absolutely steeped in the Good Samaritan. They want this society to be healthier and smarter, and their leadership is denying it because their leadership has been dominated by big money from the Koch brothers and a leadership of a Mike Hubbard and a Del Marsh who are almost primitive in their response to the needs of Alabama. And so we're going to change that conversation. We're going to make that conversation happen.
In Alabama, it's basically become a divided state where you have a Republican white electorate and a black Democrat electorate. This has been done on purpose, I believe, no matter what they say. How do you bring the two sides together and move our state forward?
Well, first of all, we air it out. We start talking about it. The people who are now in power want nostalgia politics. They want to turn that clock back. They want to go back to where they thought Alabama was comfortable, where the minorities knew their place, the Hispanics knew their place, the poor whites knew their place, and the leadership had the plantation mentality that that was a good thing. But it wasn't a good thing. And we've changed that in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, and now we've allowed ourselves, through our complacency, from our voters, sitting back and saying, surely, nobody wants to turn the clock back, but lo and behold, there are individuals who have a self-interest in making sure the status quo is the status quo. We can't allow that.
We've got about 1 minute left. One of the things that we hear a lot is that the expansion of Medicaid will create jobs. In the last 4 years, we've lost jobs, not created jobs in Alabama. How would you help create jobs?
One of the great things we could do that's available to us almost immediately is the expansion and the reformation of Medicaid. It's estimated that it will create almost 30,000 jobs. The other thing we need to do is we need to put a progressive, tolerant, open, inclusive face on Alabama. We're painting a face of Alabama that we want to be negative about who is in Alabama. We want to be negative about things. We've attacked women's rights. We've attacked Hispanics. We've attacked blacks. We're attacking science in Alabama. That can't go on because the rest of the world is listening. What I don't think people understand that are in our legislature is when they open their mouths, it is broadcast in Europe almost instantaneously. When they open their mouths and say something incredibly stupid like Scott Beeson would say or Mo Brooks would say, take them out and shoot them, or call one of our minority groups Aborigines, that is instantly all over the world, and Alabama once again paints that picture of intolerance and bigotry. We can't have that anymore.
We want to thank you for your efforts to start a dialogue with the people of Alabama, and best of luck to you.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I appreciate that.
Our guest has been Parker Griffith, gubernatorial candidate for Alabama. You're watching The V. We'll be right back.
The V is sponsored by MediaWorks Communications Video Production Services for all your video production needs.
Welcome to Alabama's newest entertainment destination, Wind Creek Wetumpka, the perfect escape for date night, a getaway with your friends, or a relaxing poolside cocktail. Whether it's a day trip to enjoy the best steak in Alabama or a romantic weekend, the finest southern hospitality is just a short drive away. Wind Creek Wetumpka. Find your winning moment.
I make sure to get your kids to school and home safe every day. I am AEA.
I make sure your child receives a healthy meal each day. I am AEA.
Thank you, AEA, for protecting our public schools and our teachers.
We are AEA.
Thank you.
Welcome back to The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Parker Griffith, he's a great guy. He's got a good message. Bentley is just too powerful.
Well, and popular. Bentley's
and by way of disclaimer, I mean, Jack and I, our business donated to Robert Bentley. I've supported Robert Bentley since before he was elected during the runoff with Bradley Byrne.
Oh, Lord, yes. We all did.
I personally
and I've had nothing but
Robert
good things
Bentley.
To say about him. So,
But Parker is an enjoyable guy. He's smart as a whip.
Yeah.
He's a very credible candidate. I just don't think he can hold a candle to
I agree with you, but for the record, he was in the House, was in Congress, and I've always been a Republican, and he was a Democrat, and I supported him and gave him
money. Well, he switched parties once, you know.
I gave him money when it was funny. I gave him money when he was a Democrat, and then he became Republican in the Democrat.
That's because you're a French Republican.
No.
There is no such thing as a French Republican.
I don't know what the hell it is
That's
either.
Some idiot who couldn't say,
Fringe.
Some goofy guy that has a radio show in Montgomery that 25 people listen to.
But Parker's a nice guy. I'm going to be supporting Bentley, but that doesn't discourage. I mean, look, competition's good.
Conversation we have to have. We got to have it here.
Well, and the Medicaid, accepting the Medicaid, Medicare money, and are we going to expand it? That's going to be the big issue this election.
Well, they'll bring some stuff to the debate.
Absolutely. They're both. We got two doctors wanting to take care of Alabama. Yeah. What could be better choices?
I think they both need to come on the show and sit down with our panel and let's talk.
Sure.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah,
it'd be great. I think it'd be great for everybody. This election, primary election, Mike Hubbard lost 6, maybe 7 seats. What did they pick up in 2010?
Lieutenants.
Yeah, fateful lieutenants. What did they pick up in 2010? 12, 16 seats, somewhere in there?
It was a bunch.
Yeah, it might have been closer to 20.
20. 20.
But anyway, he lost 6 or 7 fateful lieutenants. I think he's in trouble. What do you think, Claire?
Well, I think he's in trouble for reasons other than that, frankly.
I think
his biggest trouble is in his own backyard, not necessarily people here. Look, the people that were elected were very conservative people who ran on a different set of ideas than the people that were in office. And those ideas triumphed. And it'll be up to those folks to represent their district.
Against a bunch of money.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Avalanche of spending.
Yeah, most of these people that beat the incumbents that were funded by Mike Hubbard in 2014, they were probably outspent, 4-1?
At least.
Well, Hubbard's coming in around $1 million, only got less than 3,000 votes.
I mean, it's like over $300 per vote.
Yeah.
Could have taken them all to Ruth Chris Steakhouse for a nice dinner.
Yeah, well, and we would like that so they could, move on or something. But another one of Hubbard's clients, big client, Southeast Alabama Gas District, we understand, has had some of their folks subpoenaed. They've appeared in Lee County. I mean, how far does this thing really reach, Barron?
I don't know the answer to how far it reaches. Again, the secretive nature of the grand jury process in Alabama breeds a lot of speculation, and you don't know. You can keep track of who's coming and going if people catch word that somebody's on their way over there, or you call their office, they say he's not here, he's over testifying in Lee County. Well, you find out who's been there, and you can speculate as to why they're there. I mean, Mike Hubbard's wife's cousin runs the Southeast Alabama Gas District.
Right.
And he had a contract for, 10 grand a month.
That's pretty good.
Economic development, supposedly.
Well, and no one knows yet if they did pass any legislation that was favorable to the gas district, but it kind of smells, doesn't it?
Well, it's unusual to have a sitting Speaker of the House serve as a lobbyist.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that's not
unusual.
The only case. Now, remember, there's this whole Medicaid thing.
But I'm sure he's listed as a consultant, not a lobbyist.
No, this is the way they do it. They list it as he does economic development and marketing, because when they pass supposedly these, toothless tigers of the ethics law, as long as you say it's economic development, you don't have to report it. Yeah. You can whine, you can dine, you can do whatever you want as long as the word economic development.
So you can take bribes
I guess.
Jack, we got a bunch of runoffs coming up here.
We do.
You want to give us a handicap on a few of them?
We have one of them is Dale Peterson and Jim Ziegler. Those were two name ID races.
Right.
Some have suggested either one is the fox guarding the hen house, but I like them both. They're both very colorful characters. There's a spirited Senate race, Harris Garner versus Chambliss, which I'll talk about in the first segment, and a House race, Mac Buttram, an incumbent, only got 2% more than a mayor of Good Hope, Corey Harbison. Buttram, Harbison, and Rice ought to be pretty spirited, and I understand 2014.
And there's one more. There's Mooney and Shaver. Yeah. Up there. And there may be one other one out there. It's interesting,
well,
though.
Got, well, we got the big Secretary of State. We got the big Secretary of State. Right? You got Reese McKinney, the former private judge.
Shelnut
in Montgomery, and then a House member out of Tuscaloosa.
Shelnut and Brett King up in Senate District 17.
That's right. Beeson's old former Senator.
The interesting thing about this is 2014 PAC and the establishments have picked a horse in every one of these races. It'll be interesting to see.
If their horses lose.
If their horses win or lose, I think it could be sort of a temperature.
Well, there were no Triple Crowns this year.
You know, they will outspend all their competitors 4-1. Yeah. But as we know, these runoffs are not about money and message. They're about turnout.
Well, the Secretary of State saying 5%.
I was betting on maybe 6. That's probably right.
That's just absolutely
depends
crazy.
On if there are a lot of local races that have runoffs. You know, that'll drive up the voter
turnout.
There's
not much. Yeah. You got some on the state executive committee, folks, but that
ain't gonna drive up turnout.
You know, we were looking at some of these numbers that came back from Lee County, and it was amazing. Kathy Peterson won by 1,000 votes. Terry Dunn won by, it was around 1,000 votes. I mean, who knew? And Dial won by almost 1,000 votes. Everybody was getting 1,000 votes, but Hubbard only got 1,900. I mean, it's just a bizarre little turn. Who knew Kathy Peterson would be so popular in Lee County? I mean, doesn't that seem odd to you?
Well, both of the Petersons are just popular.
It's odd that she'd be popular anywhere.
Oh, come on now.
They've been colorful characters in politics for the last 30 years.
I like them. I just wish Dale had owned that horse of his.
Hey, look.
You're speechless, aren't you?
Hats off to them for throwing their name on the ballot. It is tough to put your name on a ballot. You will be run tarred. Through the fire, tarred feather and everything else. So hats off to anyone who put their name on the ballot.
We got about a minute left here. We just had this report out, the high cost of public corruption, how the more corrupt a state is, the less it spends on services, education, that type of thing. I mean, you ain't got any thought?
I mean, well, this Republican legislature that we have brought us in their ethics reform bill in 2010, unlimited corporate contributions, allowing you to raise money during a legislative session, and setting up dark money foundations.
Right.
That's what they brought us.
Yeah. Right. But this really is an interesting thing. Alabama ranks around between 8th and 15th in most corrupt states. We got about 30 seconds. I mean, and our social programs are terrible. Our education is terrible.
My guess is we're actually much higher than that in corruption. Yeah. And maybe this time next year our ranking will improve a little bit. Who knows?
We spent a lot of
or
money
get worse.
On public
or get worse.
All right, we got to get out of here. You've been watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. You can catch us every Sunday on your ABC stations and every day on ALReporter.com. Thank you for watching.